school that there are a lot of things that I could do, a lot of things I see now, a lot of things that went into me, into my head, and thinking that these were perhaps changing and altering things. For instance, I made a painting the other day, and it's, I see and hear very clearly sort of different instructions and different criticisms going into the picture, which were in fact criticisms that I could relate back to art schools and teachers and various things that had come at that time. So maybe this would be very valuable, this break. I don't know. And sort of to try painting again after a break of going into pop music and playing this sort of music just might work out that you get more sort of basic freedom. I don't know. It's something that just things like shape of the paper. And, seem to be a lot of assumptions taking place. I don't know.
Shadows at night, Syd Barrett, one of the founding members of Pink Floyd, has died at the age of 16. A statement from the band described him as a guiding light, leaves a legacy.
You heard a song that made the hairs on the back of your neck stand up, made you want to dance or go out and kick somebody's ass. That's what I want.
We'll be right back.
song that made the hairs on the back of your neck stand up. Made you want to dance or go out and kick somebody's ass. That's what I want. Assume an artist gets paid $1 for every record sold, less recoupable expenses. So, sell 1 million records, that's $1 million. Not bad, right? But there's that word, recoupable. That means that no matter how many records they sell, the actual cost of producing that record always comes out of the artist's end. Physically manufacturing the record, touring costs, studio space, marketing, packaging. If a drummer drinks a Pepsi in the middle of recording that album, believe me, he's paying 40 to 700%. station and find out who the band they just played was.
For example, painting at an art school, or painting, say, in infant school, the initial desire to paint, or initial first successes at painting, arise, I think, out of a very genuine, basic drive, one way or another. So, and because of family and social setups, they're channeled into success. And I think, and of course, one comes across teachers and people like that. They were what I was channeling into my own criticism. Yeah. They were what were governing what I was doing. And while it was happening, well, it happened with this painting. I mean, having finished a picture, I got through a lot of things. And one, I mean, it's quite enjoyable. You know? And the idea is to, I would like to get hold of that and be able to assimilate the system as it comes in, rather than, you know, see it as it goes out. It's not really difficult.
So you think you can tell heaven from hell and blue skies from pain? Can you tell a green field from a cold steel rail, a smile from a veil? Do you think you can tell? Did they get you to trade your heroes for ghosts, hot ashes for trees, and hot air for a cool breeze, cold comfort for change? And did you exchange a walk-on part in the war, lead role in a cage?
soul swimming in a fishbowl.
There's not many young people who sort of cause, you know, who dislike it. You know, some people think that we deliberately try and sort of shock the audience and make them, you know, by the volume, keep them quiet, sort of. But this isn't so. I mean, everybody listens. We don't need it very loud to be able to hear it. I mean, some of it is very quiet. Right? I personally like quiet music just as much as loud music. We play in large halls and things where obviously volume is necessary. But when people dance, like volume, you know, comes in on its own. When we play, I think the way the act's developed in the last 6 months has been influenced rather a lot by the fact that we've played in ballrooms necessarily, because, you know, this is obviously the first market. But I think concerts have given us a chance to realise that maybe the music we play isn't directed at dancing necessarily like normal pop groups.
Thank you. Thank you.